Welcome to Nintendo Voice Chat for the week of March 22nd, 2024, and if you follow Nintendo's calendar, you know that means it's Showtime Day. My name's Logan Plant, I'm your host for this week, filling in for Seth Macy, and I'm joined alongside Pear Schneider. Hi, Pear.
From Dog City, California.
Yeah, it's a nice background. Come watch the video version if you want to see Pear's dogs behind him.
Well, you can just see parts of dogs.
Parts of
it. Yeah, it's not very exciting view. How you doing? I'm taking a break from the Game Developers Conference. I was there all week and coming home for the show.
Yeah, it's a really busy week at IGN. GDC on the West Coast, Kat and Reber there, PAX East in Boston. Seth is there, and actually I wanted to shout out his panel real quick. He's going to be on a panel called Nintendo Gone Mad, The Zelda Games We're Trying to Forget, which is all about the Zelda CDI games, and that's on Saturday, March 23rd at 7 p.m. at the Dragonfly Theater. So if you're at PAX East, make sure to go say hi to Seth, and Jared Petty's on that panel and a few other people. And Seth is arranging an NVC photo ahead of time at 6:30 outside the Dragonfly. So if you want to meet Seth, then go say hi at 6:30. That's tomorrow night if you're listening to this the day it goes up. And Pear, what you got there? What is that?
Logan, this is a game I'd like to forget. It's one of three games that I own. I couldn't find the other ones in a box somewhere that I would like to forget. And then they're the CDI Philips games, or as we call them, the Giddy games, because Nintendo felt some sort of, you know, obviously being partnered with Philips. Philips was meant to be the developer of the CD-ROM drive for the Nintendo 64, whatever console it would become. Nintendo probably felt like it needed to support its partner and license them Zelda, and the outcome were three really terrible games.
And you've played them, you said, but not all the way to the end.
No, because they're not, it's just not fun. It's like the CDI was it's an interactive CD player, basically, right? And so it had some very basic graphics capabilities, and it's just not a good device. Imagine like games that you play with a remote control where like when you press the button, like a second later something happens. They're like that. And the system really was more designed for interactive CD-ROM stuff, like select something from the menu. And then they created these two platformers in this overhead Zelda game, and you know, obviously they're made in the West. I have nothing to do with Nintendo. All the characters and worlds are unique to this game. Like it says, Ganon and his minions have seized the peaceful island of Koridai and imprisoned Zelda. It is written only Link can defeat Ganon, and so you set out on this quest that's basically single screen, you beat some people with a sword, and it's super choppy and awful, and then by like, there's like 70 screens, by screen 5 you're like, oh, kill me. And then it has all those animated cutscenes, right? Like some of them are famous that are in the style of the animated show that are just very, very embarrassing with the voiced Link and all that. And then the Zelda's adventure game is actually overhead. It's not as terrible, but that's just basically being nice. It's a very unresponsive, like, overworld game where you walk around. It's a little bit more like the, you know, the classic style where it scrolls. So, but ugly. You can see like the frame rate is like one frame per hour.
Yeah. I can't even believe those models, those characters, those backgrounds. It's bad. It's really bad. But yeah. Seth's going to be talking about those. And I think they're also talking about Arzette, the Jewel of Faramore. That's a game we've talked about on NBC before earlier this year. But that's like the spiritual successor to the Zelda CDI games. That's actually like a better version of what those were kind of intended to be back in the day.
Look, they're fun to play because they're funny, right? But they're very bad games. There's just no strategy, right? Like there's like a random, the NPC walks around in random patterns. And like your ability to hit them isn't based on your skill or your reaction time or your planning. It's just whether the controller actually responds. Yeah.
Yeah, no good.
Yeah, I mean, it was a funny time, right? Where Nintendo felt like it needed to, you know, it needed to work with a partner and license some of its properties. And it seemed non-competitive or non-disruptive, right? Like it wasn't taking away from the quality of the games on their platform. And so they did this and stuff like Hotel Mario and, you know, yeah, now it's an interesting footnote in Zelda history.
Enough about terrible Nintendo games from 30 years ago. Let's talk about a good Nintendo game from today. Princess Peach Showtime is out today, the day you're listening to this. I reviewed it. It's up on IGN right now, and I gave it a 7, which means good. Also, we finally can share that Goodfeel did develop this game. That was kind of what came out last week, and we talked about it. And Nintendo's being so secretive about who's making its games, and we'll talk about that more in a little bit. But yep, this is a Goodfeel game, so the same partner they worked with on Yoshi's Craft World, Yoshi's Woolly World, Kirby's Epic Yarn, and I think Wario Land Shake It is the other main Nintendo game that they've made. But yeah, I really liked my time with Princess Peach Showtime. I thought that it was cute, it's fun, it's simple. It kind of the vibes we were sussing out from it ahead of time of that kind of vein of a Kirby game or a Yoshi game is definitely accurate pair. It's really kid-friendly, really simple. You use basically only two buttons, and you're probably not going to die if you play through this game. I only died once when I played through to a boss kind of near the end of the game, but I still had a nice time with it.
Yeah, I like a lot about the game. I've only played the demo and then, you know, watched your review. Great job on that one, Logan.
Thank you.
I like that it exists. I like that Nintendo's making games for younger folks, right? There were some really cool games back in the days, you know, outside of just the sort of edutainment realm. There were games like, there was an awesome Winnie the Pooh game, right? Like, it was just made with love, but it's like, yeah, you didn't die in it, and it wasn't, the puzzles weren't complicated. And so as an adult player, you might not be excited about the sort of challenge level and the gameplay it provides, but it is such, it's really nice when people are using existing licenses and bringing them to life in a charming way. And like, that's how I feel about this game. It's almost ironic that, you know, the developer's name is Goodfeel, because one of the challenges they have, and I brought this up on a previous episode with Mamedano Bakeru, which is the real spiritual successor to the Goemon games, right? That's, again, like part of the team that made Goemon, including the lead director on it, on the old Goemon games, worked on that title. The games don't feel that great. And that's because I think the developer is struggling with hardware, or maybe the development times are a little bit too confined, a little bit too short. And so Mamida no Bakaru, it doesn't run at 60 like the Goemon games did, right? And the Goemon games felt really tight, and the platforming was really good. And so Mamida no Bakaru is a little choppy, and like, it doesn't feel as good. I'm wondering about, like, how does this feel? I heard your complaints about the mermaid game, and that it wasn't, like, it just didn't feel right. Is that right?
Yeah, so it mostly feels fine, and I think that is just part of the nature of this game, that is 11 different styles, because you have basic Princess Peach and then the 10 different transformations. Unfortunately, there's really no secret transformations that they add later on. This is the bulk of the game. You're getting 3 levels each as these 10 transformations for 30 levels total, along with some boss fights in there and some optional challenge levels in there. But no, they pretty much kind of showed most of what this game is in the pre-release, which I was also a little bit bummed by, but... most of them feel fine. I wouldn't say any feel bad. I called out the mermaid just because it has this rhythm game where you're basically trying to point the stick in the direction that the notes are swimming towards Peach. And sometimes the timing is just weird. It's a rhythm game, but it doesn't always feel like the notes line up with the music that's playing, which is kind of really bad for a rhythm game. So that's kind of a miss there. But no, they mostly feel fine. Jumping is pretty floaty in most of them. It's not a precision platformer like a Super Mario Brothers game. It is more of a lighthearted adventure with some platforming elements. So yeah, but some of them actually feel pretty good to play as. Like Mighty Peach is the superhero sci-fi transformation, and she picks up these UFOs and she throws them at waves of enemies. And it's pretty fun and exciting. And this game is more cinematic than your standard Nintendo platformer. Like, there's lots of zoom in cutscenes, lots of slow motion action. A lot of the levels end in boss encounters, which are actually pretty exciting and good. They're easy to get through, but they're cool one-on-one duels in the Kung Fu Peach levels with a lot of quick time events, but it kind of looks like Street Fighter at times. Like, it's cool. It's cooler to look at than it is to play, which make of that what you will, but that's kind of how I feel about it.
Yeah, no, and that was my initial reaction based on the demo I played. You know, the game feel wasn't as great as I was hoping for, but that's not the main attraction for every game, right? Some of my favorite games of all time don't nail game feel. The Witcher 3, it's a freaking awesome game, but it is a little bit more in the vein of, you know, Elder Scrolls, Skyrim, which also has this sort of the the weapons feel heavy and delayed, right, when you use them, or you conjure a spell and it takes a second. Not to bring it back to Link, the Faces of Evil, right? But like the HCI, the input isn't as snappy as it could be because the game does all these other things, right? Like these big RPGs, they're literally rolling. There's a little man inside your game who rolls the 8-sided or the 20-sided dice.
I didn't know that's how it works.
Yeah, no, that's little man in there. And so those games succeed based on something else, and that's sort of like the vastness of the world and the exploration. And I feel like with Princess Peach's solo outing here, we get sort of like the character development, seeing how they nail all these different gameplay types. I can't wait to play the detective one. That one looks really good.
Yeah, the detective one is one of my favorites, and probably just because I love that genre so much. I love Ace Attorney so much. So Detective Peach was a lot of fun. She points at witnesses to call them out on their BS, which is really cute. And yeah, it's not this big sweeping mystery that's going to stump or surprise you, but it's just super cute to see all of these different gameplay genres, whether it's a Wild West game like we're seeing on screen right now with Cowgirl Peach, or a detective game with Detective Peach, and just seeing how Nintendo and Goodfeel have kind of boiled down the essence of those genres into their simplest parts and then put it together into a cute little 10-minute segment that kids are going to be able to get through pretty much no problem. I think it's a really cool thing, and it's something that we haven't really seen a Nintendo game do before. I think that's something I really like about Showtime, is it totally exists as its own thing. The only recognizable Mario things are Peach herself and then the two toads that follow her to the Sparkle Theater, but that's it. It's all new enemies, all new abilities, all new characters, and I really applaud them for that, because I think it would have been really easy to just do like another Super Princess Peach where it's a 2D platformer and it doesn't really try anything super new, but this game goes for it in a lot of really cool ways, and I adore the presentation. I think that just like Yoshi's Woolly World or Crafted World look like a craft room or look like a yarn shop, this looks like a theater, and enemies held up by puppet strings or backgrounds built out of cardboard or the spotlight that's always shining on Peach and other characters. It's just super cool and unique, and I really love that. And I kind of feel like how I'm wondering if it felt after the first Luigi's Mansion, where it's like, wow, this could be something. This could be a franchise. If they come back to it, they blow it up a little bit. I want to see a Showtime sequel in a new theater with new transformations, because I think they have something good here.
Yeah, it's a little bit like Paper Mario as well, right? The first game kind of set up this different style for the world and the characters, and it didn't quite nail it yet. And then over time, you know, as you got sequels, like, it got better and better. I thought the last Paper Mario, some of the environments were just so cool, you know, like this kind of mixture of like super vibrant colors, this like, you know, Japanese kind of Edo village setting, all of that were just really, really neat. We got a question from one of our listeners, Andy, for you. And he's asking, how's the resolution and performance? I noticed the actual Peach model was the fuzziest thing in the demo compared to the sharp, crisp NPCs and backgrounds. The game also dropped in frame rate on cutscenes. Is the final version better?
Sadly, it is not better. What you see in the demo is what you're going to get in the final game. And it's fascinating because the performance and the frame rate is never actually bad during the gameplay. It's during everything else. During the cutscenes, I have an example in the video review where Peach's assistant, Stella, just completely freezes for like over a second during this cutscene. And it stutters, and the loading screens is supposed to be like this curtain that's ruffling in the wind. And it just is a slideshow when you're watching this thing happen, and then it just, you feel like it's creaky and it's just chugging to get into the game. And then occasionally in some of the moments with more action, like I remember once there's this moment where Peach hurls this UFO at this bigger spaceship to destroy it, and she's whipping the UFO around in circles, and it's just starting to chug, and you can just see the seams breaking a little bit, and it always manages to recover and get through the end, but it's not great. And yeah, the resolution, I played some other Mario games that are on Switch just to try and compare, and Mario Wonder, I think, is just an absolutely gorgeous video game. And I played Mario Wonder back to back with Peach, and you go back into Peach, and yeah, she just looks blurry and fuzzy pretty much all the time, especially when she's further back in the background. So no, from that angle, the presentation and performance is not the greatest, but it's not terrible. But that's coming from someone who, I'm primarily a Nintendo player. I don't super care about frame rate that much compared to gameplay and presentation and overall aesthetic. So it didn't bug me that much, but it might bug you more than it bugged me.
And it, you know, obviously the decision there is, does the target audience care, right? Kids are not gonna care. Maybe, you know, they can detect if a game is really snappy and in a less tangible way. But you know, there's not a kid who's gonna go and borrow. The frame rate is not up to my standards, right?
Yeah.
Except that could be a future IGN editor then. I hear you on that. I've been playing the new Mud Runner on Xbox.
Mm-hmm.
Do you know Mud Runner? It's basically your car stuck in the mud and get really, really mad, and then you're still stuck 40 minutes later and you use a winch to winch yourself up. The predecessor, Snow Runner, is on Switch, and it's a great game. I love it. It's just very frustrating. And that game launched on Xbox, where every 3 seconds the game stutters. Like, it's called Expeditions Mud Runner. And it's like, you drive a little bit and it stops like a split second. You drive a little bit, it stops a split second. Turns out when they tested this game, they didn't test it with the Xbox netcode too well. And so once it was out in a real life environment on an Xbox, not in their dev situation where they're disconnected from the web, it starts to stutter. So if you turn off your internet, it runs smoothly.
That's so strange.
But then after like 2 minutes, the game will nag you to turn your internet back on because it's always connected. So it's like, it's this sort of stuff that can happen. And so the things you describe where in a cutscene something freezes, I feel like that's going to get patched. That's just an issue with a game not getting enough time in the sort of final environment and final testing. Whereas like the overall frame rate, that's probably going to stay the same, right?
Yeah, and it's fine. It targets 30 and usually is hitting that. So it's not bad from a performance perspective. It's nothing like Scarlet and Violet, which deserved to get really bad press for their performance at launch. It's not like they should have delayed this game. They shouldn't have shipped it yet. It's fine to ship in the state that it's in, but it's just, I think Luigi's Mansion 3 is like a 60 FPS, pretty much locked game, and Mario Wonder's the same way, and Mario Odyssey runs at a great frame rate. And so this one just isn't quite up to snuff with those quite as much. I also want to talk a little bit about kind of the extra stuff squeezed out of the game, the collectibles and reasons to go back and the replayability, because that's something I was disappointed in, and it's something I usually think Nintendo really nails. And this game has a ton of stuff to collect. There are 10 sparkle gems in each act one for every transformation, and then 8 or so in the second act, and then fewer in the third act, that it reduces over time because the levels get shorter as you go on with each transformation. And that's great, right? There's a lot of stuff to go and find, and some of them are hidden pretty well. I am usually pretty good at sneaking around and finding where Nintendo hides stuff in its games, but I missed something in a lot of the levels in Showtime. But unfortunately, I don't really want to go back and find them because the levels stretch from 10 to 15 minutes for the act one, and there's no like chapter select. I think Celeste is a great example of a game that has strawberries hidden as you're climbing this mountain. And once you beat the game, you can go back and pick, okay, I'm going to start at this point of the level because it's telling me there's 2 strawberries in this checkpoint I missed. You can't do that in Princess Peach Showtime. So if you want to go back to the sword fighter level where you missed the 8th sparkle gem, you have to play through all of the cutscenes and all of the little dialogue and all of the little cute stuff to get all the way to that portion where you missed 1 sparkle gem. Hopefully you find it. We're going to have an IGN guide where you will be able to find it if you want to use that. And then you have to complete the level. You can't back out of the level once you get it. And the levels are just a little bit too long for my liking to go back and really hunt everything down. So I've pretty much already put this game down after finishing it because I just personally, I'd have to basically replay the entire game to 100% it. So I think that it's the formula is a little off there with this one.
Interesting. So I ran into this in the demo. You know, like sometimes you have a game where the game doesn't clearly communicate which path leads to the exit and which path is a diversion, right? Like Mario games do this sometimes too, where you've got a pipe and you're like, oh, do I go through that one to progress, or is there another way? And sometimes they play with that sort of expectation where maybe a level goes on after the flagpole or something, right? And in this game, in the demo, I saw there was like a doorway or something. I'm like, oh, this must be the exit of the level. Let me go look to the right to see if there's a sparkle thing hidden there. And then I went to the right, and it turns out that was the path forward. I faced a mini boss battle, and then you couldn't go backwards, right? Like the game basically shut the door behind you. And so then I was thinking about it, like, okay, so I need to replay the level to get to that point and collect the thing. And I was in the same boat as you are. But, you know, I will tell you that my kids are ancient now, but when they were little, they loved that sort of repetition, right? For them, it was this sort of, they loved to play the same level again and again, and, you know, just kind of like see the characters, the animations, the reactions, and all of that. Just kids watch the same movie or listen to the same song 100 times in a row, too. So to them, it's probably not an issue. And again, as a parent, I think that it's a wonderful choice of a game then.
Yeah, I was actually thinking about that exact thing that you just brought up about how kids watch the same movie over and over and over. And I was thinking, oh, then maybe, like you just said, it wouldn't be an issue. But then I was wondering, but are kids the one who are going to go back and want to collect everything? Or is it us that want to go back and do that? So it just feels like you're kind of crossing audiences there a little bit in a way that, disappointed me. I 100% had Mario Wonder, Captain Toad, Yoshi's Woolly World. Like, I have the sparkly 5-star file on all of these games. And yeah, this one's not going to be joining that, sadly, because like we're seeing footage right now. We just saw the cowgirl level where you do this kind of on rails Wild West horseback chase, and it's really cool and fun, and you're jumping between the foreground and the background. But oh, there's a horse that's riding away that has a sparkle gem on it, and you have 2 seconds to get up there and grapple it, or you missed it and you have to restart the entire level if you want a chance to do that again. It's just a little bit disappointing for me, because I was thrilled at how many collectibles there were, but then when that realization kind of hit, I was like, oh, well, I don't really recommend playing this 15-minute thing again. So that was a bit of a bummer, but I still really enjoyed my time with it. I really liked the kind of non-violent levels a lot more, the detective one or the figure skater one or the patisserie one where you're decorating cakes. I thought that those were all really, really smart gameplay ideas that they introduced, where some of the combat ones just feel like you're hitting the same button over and over to dispatch wave after wave of pushover enemies. So there's cool stuff here. I think if you're a parent listening, kids are going to love this. I think that this is a really, really good one to play with the family. Where Mario Wonder, I know some people struggled with the multiplayer aspects of this one. This one's not multiplayer, but still, I think it'd be fun to sit down, pass around the controller, and play this with everybody, because it's really cute. And it's just awesome to see Peach get her own game after almost 20 years since the last one. And I think this one is much better than that one was.
So NVC listener Patrick says, I believe Princess Peach Showtime is confirmed to have been developed by Good Feel Now. You brought this up earlier. Let's talk about that for a second, because when a couple of episodes ago when I was on, we talked about whether this was another Good Feel game, and I was like, maybe not, because they were busy with the Mamedano Bakaru game, and maybe it isn't, but they clearly had the capacity to work on multiple games. In hindsight, it's really funny, because the sort of, like, if you go back to the classic Goemon games, and I played a ton of them, and they actually change genres over time, right? Like, The development team at Konami Osaka at the time, they were really adept at doing a bunch of different gameplay styles. Like, you could play Gradius in Goemon, in Mystical Ninja, the Super NES one that came out here. In the sequel, it had these, just like the first one, it has these town sequences where you can move in and out of the foreground, just like this game, just like Showtime, right? When you're moving, you're not just moving on a straight line, you can move in and out. And so it did remind me of those town sequences. And then once you enter a level, it switches to a single plane, kind of more platformer. But the difference in the Goemon games is those platform levels run at 60 most of the time. They have a ton of slowdown when there's lots of stuff on screen. Remember slowdown, when the game would just go into slow motion because it couldn't handle all that stuff? But it still felt really, really tight and really good. And we found out the director on this game is Etsunobu Ebisu, right? And it's like the first game that he's directing in a long time. What's notable,
like,
about him
years,
is... 25
years, the headline said, or something like that? It has
been, yeah. You know, if you go back, he's the person who inspired the Goemon sidekick, the Ebisu Maru, his name is. He was like, what, Doc Yang in the bad translated Goemon game. But the blue guy with a weird mustache who, when he crouches, he crawls up on his back. He's kind of a weird, dirty old man kind of character. And he's meant to be inspired by the game's director, Ebisu, which is funny. I don't know how flattering that is.
Yeah, not very.
Yeah, it's kind of cool to see the DNA of those games reflected in Showtime now, you know? And so now you knew it was made by Goodfeel. Nintendo, for some reason, embargoes information like what's in the credits.
And
And
wouldn't
we
this have been
can.
a cool story to share about this game leading up to its launch? It's so bizarre, Pear.
So let's talk about it because I'm of two minds. There are two things going on at Nintendo. One is Nintendo definitely has a thing about not always telling you who made something,
Yeah.
and I don't know all the reasons for it. I have a good example in a second. The other one is Nintendo of America may not know. And so instead of saying, we'll find out and get back to you, they're like, oh, we're not going to find out. You know, just let it go. And it's like, just watch the credits and you'll know. And it
Yeah,
is
but someone
very,
at
very
NOA made
possible.
those translated credits, right? Don't the localizers create those credit sequences?
Yeah, okay, but we talked to execs or PR people, and they might not be in the loop. Like
That's true. Yeah.
the people playing the games, the Treehouse people probably know who made it. But that's the confounding thing. Why not just say, oh, it's made by Goodfeel. Remember those guys? They used to work on all the Goemon games. Great story. It would have gotten coverage for this game. People would have said, hey, that's really awesome to see that that team is still around. And oh, look at the similarities there, right? Like, to me, there's no negative angle.
Yeah, I
Why do you
agree.
think?
Sorry, go ahead.
Yeah. No, and then so I was going to ask you, what do you think? Like, if we go down the other route, and Red is kindly bringing up a screen here of CA Productions or Cap Productions. This is their Japanese developer website, right? And you can see some of the games they worked on. For our listeners, stuff like Super Mario Party, Mario Party Star Rush. They worked on the casual games thing. What was it called again in the US? The 51
Clubhouse
casual
Games,
games,
Worldwide
Clubhouse
Classics.
games,
Yeah.
right? And so now, as we keep scrolling, you see they're the named developer on their website for a bunch of big games: Mario Party 10, Wii Party. And then you get to 2009, you're like, Wii Software Development Corporation. Okay, so maybe they did some small stuff, but Red, keep scrolling. Because we're going to get to Wing Island, which is, by the way, this was the developer that worked on Sky Odyssey, amazing flight game for the PlayStation 2. They did the not so amazing Wing Island on Wii, which kind of recalled some of it. But now you're in the early 2000s, and you see after Sky Odyssey, they worked on software for Nintendo 64. They worked on Nintendo GameCube software 2002. Those are instances where in the contract with Nintendo, and this was a thing in Japan, and it is still in many ways. They are the stealth developer. They are making the game, but they're never to disclose that they worked on the game. You know, sometimes some of the names appear in the credits. That's even with Sky Odyssey, they weren't really credited as a developer for it either. But like you'll eventually find out some of that stuff through the people who worked on it. But there's a deliberate movement to say, you know, we're Nintendo, we make quality software. And so when you buy a Nintendo game, it says published by Nintendo, made by
Yes.
Nintendo, and that's all you need to know, right? That's the approach.
You go to a fancy restaurant and they say it's this chef, but maybe it's a sous chef that actually made your meal, but they don't want you to know that. I feel like it's kind of similar to that, but I think it's kind of hurts them. I don't know. I don't know. I think that might be dramatic to say it hurts them, but it bothers hardcore fans like us because we want to know who made these games. And the Yoshi games that Goodfeel made
Yeah.
last for Nintendo are very well liked. People like Woolly World and Crafted World. It's not like these are games they swept under the rug that people didn't enjoy. And Kirby's Epic Yarn is a fan favorite in that franchise. And Wario Land Shake It is the last real Wario platform we ever got. Like, they have a great pedigree within Nintendo software, and I'm not
Yeah.
sure why they don't want us to know ahead of time, hey, if you're a fan of these Yoshi games, you're going to like this Peach game. Because yeah, I knew it was Goodfeel while I was playing it before the credits rolled. I could just tell. I could tell it was them
Yeah.
based on the look. They make all these craft type games, so the backgrounds of the stage play totally fit in with the Epic Yarns and the Woolly Worlds. And I just think it's a bizarre thing that they're doing right
And
now.
it happened a lot with the Mario Party games, where many of them are either credited to Nintendo or Hudson, and turns out no, it was neither of those companies. They were all farmed out, and it was obfuscated. It was not disclosed who actually made them, and so it started to become this sort of story. And like I think in the case of some of the Mario Parties, Hudson wasn't even seen as a very valuable developer, right? They have a pedigree of some really good games, obviously with Bomberman, but they also made quite a lot of stinkers, and so. I don't know. It just seems like such a weird strategy. And it definitely was a thing where certain developers were paid extra to deliver the product and not get the credit for it and not ever disclose it. And so, yeah, some of the games, like if I line up the dates of these games, 2001 Nintendo 64 game, that's Dr. Mario 64. If I had 2002 Nintendo GameCube game, I don't know, maybe Master Quest? Maybe they did the GameCube release of Zelda Master Quest, right? Like, we may never know. We may never be able to fill in the gaps, and we can only guess at some of this stuff. And yeah. Oh, look at you running it in translation. Fancy. Thank you, Red, brought it up. So I hope that this old strategy goes away, and that when you have a good developer who is creating these games, you proudly list them and credit them. And I hope that eventually the mobile games business goes the same route, because like finding out who made a mobile game is almost impossible. Developers are almost never credited. Apple or Google storefronts don't tell you who made the game. Sometimes it's shell companies who are republishing games. Heck, games change names all the time. It's frustrating. Stop it.
Yeah, and we're the right panel to talk about this, because we're the guys that are constantly in the IGN database plugging all this information in. So maybe hits a bit closer to home for us than to you listening to it. But from a Nintendo perspective, I've just noticed that it becomes the story of launch day is who made this game. And granted, the hardcore bubble that we exist in that is following this news daily that actually cares what team made this game is small. It is not the wider audience of families that's going to go and pick up Princess Peach Showtime over the weekend or this upcoming holiday. But still, it bugs me that on IGN.com or on VGC, the story of these launch days is, oh, we finally know who voiced Mario in Mario Wonder. We finally know who made Super Mario RPG. It's weird, and I want them to shake it. And yeah, if you guys are listening, stop doing that, because it's really strange, and I don't know who it's helping, because we find out eventually. So you might as well just tell us up front. Yeah.
Yeah, the Mario voice one, I feel like, was a different story, but similar concept, right? Like, why not just say?
Yeah, very weird. Very weird. But that's Princess Peach Showtime. Go check out my review on IGN.com, written version and a video version. It's a 7. It's good. I liked it. It's the big Q1 release for Nintendo this year. But that's Princess Peach. Let's talk about Super Mario Maker. Because last week during Miiverse, I shouted out Team 0%, which is the Super Mario Maker team that is working to clear every single level in the Wii U game before the server shut down. I interviewed a bunch of them, and that article is also up on IGN.com right now. But right now, we're going to toss to an interview with one member of Team 0% to tell us all about the one level remaining that no one has beaten. This thing is crazy. You're going to want to see what this thing looks like. So we'll toss it to that interview right now on Nintendo Voice Chat. We're back on Nintendo Voice Chat. I'm Logan Plant, and this time I'm joined by Mario Maker streamer and Team 0% member Tyler, also known as The Beast. Thanks so much for joining us. Why don't you introduce yourself and a little bit of your Mario Maker background?
Yeah, so I go by TheBeast721, it's my username, but I got into Mario Maker pretty much maybe a month after the game release, and pretty much every day since then been playing that, and now we have Super Mario Maker 2, but always tried to play, you know, kind of some of the harder stuff and just challenge myself, and it's pretty cool. The community there's some really skilled people out there both playing and designing. It's just a really unique game, and I love it.
Yeah, so we've been talking a lot on NVC and on IGN about Team 0%, which is this Mario Maker group who's working to clear every single uncleared level in Super Mario Maker on Wii U before the Wii U servers shut down next month. That's only a few weeks away now. And as we speak, as we're recording this, there's one level left, and it's called Trimming the Herbs. And Tyler, you've been streaming it over on Twitch for many hours a day, just trying to grind out this one level. We're showing some footage of it here. Walk us through what we're seeing and why it's so incredibly difficult.
Yeah, so it's funny that the average person who watches this, they think, yeah, this looks challenging, but is this really stumping the community? Like, I've seen you guys play much, much harder stuff, and It's really kind of invisible difficulty. So you'll see I'm trying to drop the bomb on these plant stacks, which the name Trimming the Herbs is perfect for how the level is. You have to drop the bomb and only kill the top plant, not the bottom, which it turns out that's a frame perfect drop. The game runs at 60 FPS, so it's 1/60th of a second window. And that's not even the hard part. People, we've gotten pretty decent at doing that, but the invisible difficulty is crossing these gaps over the saws. It is just, it's so, so hard. And you might think, well, just push right when you start bouncing, but it's not so simple. You can do something called, we call it a float jump or a re-grab, where to make Mario jump, you press the jump button, but if you press jump after he's bounced on the enemy, he kind of, it lowers his fall speed, basically, so okay. It allows you to cross that gap, but the maker knew that and made you have, not only have to do it, but have to do it very well, and you'll see if somebody tries this level, you can try it yourself if you still have the game, and you cannot cross that gap unless you really know what you're doing. It is so hard. You have to do it 3 times. And there's only been 2 people who've made it past this beginning segment with the plant stacks. That's probably 500-600 hours collectively in the community at this point. And that's the best we've got to show for it. It's really, really hard.
Yeah, this is crazy. If you're listening to the audio version of our show, I encourage you to hop over to IGN.com or to YouTube to watch this portion of the podcast, because we are just watching, it's a Super Mario World level in Super Mario Maker, and we are just watching attempt after attempt of Mario riding up this little skeleton rail, getting launched into this crazy spike gauntlet with piranha plants and bombs and chainsaws, and yeah, and at this point, you're just dying over and over at the same first segment, and I tuned into some of your Twitch stream and I saw that there's a couple attempts where you get a little bit lower into the next stack of piranha plants and the next one after that, but 500-600 hours and people haven't managed to do it yet when you've been able to clear every other level in the game. It's crazy. Did you expect that it would take this long once you got down to one?
So there, this project has been going on for ages and it's recently picked up in the last couple months, and since I've been playing this game and was pretty involved in the community, I kind of knew what was floating around out there. And I'm like, oh, there's no way they can do this, because sometimes people will make a level and it's a hard trick, like do a frame perfect wall jump and do it 150 times in a row because they find that fun. If you don't know, if you make a level in this game, to put it up, you have to prove that you can beat it yourself or you can't upload it. So I thought, well, those levels are boring. Nobody's going to take the time to beat it, but they did. And I vaguely remember this level. The maker is known in the community, but he actually has a much crazier level that was beaten before this project even started picking up, but I think that's because it's way more famous compared to this one. This level was just kind of forgotten unless you're one of the like real hardcore community members. And now this is what we're left with. And it's crazy. It's so short. Every run usually dies within about 2 seconds. So anytime you get 3 seconds in, it gets a little exciting. And I would have thought this would have been beaten by now, but it turns out it's really hard. I think it's hard to stay motivated just because progress is so slow. Like getting 4 seconds in is really exciting, and that might take several hours to do, so it's hard to feel like you're improving. But I do see people getting better, and I think we can do this. But it's definitely an uphill battle. But yeah, this level specifically would not have been the type of level I picked, as this is going to be the one that is the last one. It's kind of surprising to me.
Yeah, it's gaining a lot of notoriety very quickly in the Mario Maker community. And it's funny because, like I mentioned, I ran that story on IGN earlier this week about Team 0% and the mission to clear all the levels. And my initial plan was to run this story after you all did it, after the mission was complete and you were at 0%. And then I was talking to some folks in the Team 0% Discord and they were like, yeah, I don't know how long it's going to take for trimming the herbs to get finished. And yeah, it's been down to just this level for 5 or 6 days now, almost a week. It was last weekend that trimming the herbs became the only level remaining. And yeah, as the days go on, we're approaching this, I believe it's April 8th that Nintendo is shutting down the Wii U servers. Are you concerned at all that it's not going to happen before then?
I feel like I keep going back and forth every day. I see like some people that I'm trusting to take this down for us being like, oh, I don't know. And I'm like, oh gosh, if they're scared, then I don't know how I feel. But then somebody else is like, oh, look, I just did this and got my PB. And I'm like, okay, yeah, we're still getting better. I don't think it's a guarantee for sure. The second half of this level is much easier than this beginning part. The beginning part is what's stumped everybody, but it's still not easy. It's just easier. So once somebody gets past this beginning, I imagine whoever does it first, after now the level's gotten so much more popular, they're just going to, oh my gosh, what do I do? And freak out and immediately die. And then, but hopefully after that first freak out attempt, if you have a 5% consistency rate at the second part of the level, then hopefully that 5% comes through, and the more people who are trying that are good enough to beat it, the more of those 5% rolls we get. And I like to think that it's going to happen, but I also understand it might not. We're struggling. This has really stumped a lot of us. It's crazy.
It's truly an epic final boss that I don't think anybody planned for, and it's kind of cool in that way. And there's an enormous bounty out on trimming the herbs right now for whoever clears this. People are putting up like Twitch subscribers or Discord Nitro months of subscriptions, and like it's gotten up there in value for whoever actually clears this thing. Like it's really fun to follow. If the level is not beaten by the time this episode goes up on Friday morning, we're here recording Thursday afternoon, so anything could change in that time, but I encourage you to all go out and watch just what's happening with trimming the herbs, because it's really fun. And you're streaming it, if you want to shout out where you're streaming it and where people can come and watch you.
Yeah, I stream it on Twitch on my channel, the B721. Pretty much most days I'm playing it now. I really didn't expect to play this level, because I loved playing these 0% levels, but this one, I think back in December is when somebody first kind of pointed out, like, hey, you guys remember this? Like, this one might give us some trouble. And I was like, somebody else will do it. It's not going to be me. And now it's either play this or nothing. So you may as well try, but I'm getting better every day. And there's, I'd say, at least 15 people that I know of who I think really have a shot to beat this. And most are playing every day or every other day whenever they get time.
That's great.
And yeah, it's a monster.
So that's trimming the herbs. That's the final level in Super Mario Maker. But let's talk a little bit about the journey to get here. You mentioned you've been on board with Super Mario Maker since pretty much right after the game came out. And you've been creating a lot of, or tackling a lot of these really fun 0% levels with no completions. What are some of the craziest levels or tech or stories that you've experienced in Mario Maker?
Yeah, so it's a pretty interesting project. Because technically, anybody who's played this game has contributed, because even if you've beaten some random level made by a 5-year-old kid, like, if you were the first one to beat it, you helped us. We didn't have to do that later on. But it kind of really took off, I think, in 2017. It just started as a joke, and we kind of liked the idea of, let's find these old levels. It's kind of like a trip down memory lane, a history lesson in the game, in a way. But yeah, there were so many levels. There was a big push by the team. The initial goal was to beat all the levels. The game released in 2015, so we wanted to beat all the 2015 levels. And there's one really notorious level. It was called Wall in Front of the Eye. It was, I don't know who made it, somebody in Japan. But a guy named the Z7 beat it, and you had to fly, like, with the cape flying, not spin flying, where it's easy to fly with zero speed, but regular flight between two spikes, like in a one tile gap. And it just looked horrible. And that's maybe the middle of the level. There's also all this other hard stuff. And it's crazy to think, because as the years go by, we get better and better collectively as a community. We share knowledge, look at these cool tricks, things like that. But it's pretty interesting to be like, wow, somebody was good enough to come up with this idea and beat this back in the day. It's pretty neat.
Is this
most of the levels that I personally remember?
Do you know which level this is we're looking at?
This is, I'm assuming this is, oh, this is a Ryukar level. I see it. I used to have a bar on the top of my screen. There used to be a bookmark site for Mario Maker 1, and we could pull level info. I don't recognize this level, but I definitely remember playing a lot of Ryukar levels. Yeah, usually the ones I remember from doing this are the worst levels, like the well-designed, we call them Kaizo levels, or they're fun, but you remember the ones that are just hidden blocks everywhere and trying to trick you, and they hide the star behind a saw or something. And I've played several levels that just you want to forget about, and they are something.
Do you count levels? Let's say somebody is a troll and hides a route that you can't actually see exists when you're just playing the level. Like, you can climb all these hidden blocks to get up to the top of the screen and then run across and avoid all the nonsense that they created below. Do those count in terms of 0%ing, or there's some levels like that that your team has kind of ruled out over the years that, yeah, we're not going to complete this total troll level?
No, every level, if the level has been beaten, we do it. There are certain occasions, so Nintendo would update the game and, you know, either add new content, or in the average case, they would change the way the underlying physics of the game worked. And it's usually fine, but let's say somebody built a level with a really weird trick or interaction or a glitch, and then they update the game to fix that glitch. Well, they proved they beat it before and uploaded it, and now the glitch doesn't work anymore, so you can't beat it. But Nintendo was smart. They keep a version of the game stored with the level, so that this is that level I was talking about, Wall in Front of the Eye.
This is crazy.
They keep the physics of the level with basically like an old version of the game stored with the level, and thankfully you can still beat it. But sometimes they would change the game and it would not do that. I'm not sure why. It seemed kind of arbitrary, and the level just became impossible.
And in those situations, you would report them to Nintendo, and then those levels would be removed, correct? So you didn't have to worry about them.
Right, and still today, like, the game's about to be shut down, they were following our reports, and if we found one that couldn't be beaten, somebody working there would delete it, which I thought was really cool. I thought, there's no way somebody's looking at these, but I guess they are. As long as the level can be beaten, we've beaten every single one of them, other than the one.
Yeah. So are you a Super Mario fan in general, like the original Super Mario World, Mario 3? Do you like those games, or did Mario Maker draw you in just because of the crazy difficult nature of it and the community aspect of it?
Yeah, so I played Mario growing up like most people, but I kind of stopped around the Wii and the Wii U. I didn't get those consoles, and I actually didn't know Mario Maker was a thing until I saw it on Reddit, like a viral level from Panga. He's a really well-known level creator. I thought, wow, that looks really cool. Like, I've only seen Mario as this chill jumping game, but this is a real challenge. Like, I want to do that. And I was hooked. But yeah, I hadn't really played Mario games since Mario Sunshine, I guess, on the GameCube before Mario Maker. But now I'm kind of back into replaying all the old games, and definitely Mario Maker is the one that gives me the most joy, just because I enjoy the challenge. And the original games, they're very fun, but Nintendo's not going to put out something that takes 5 hours to clear a level, because everybody would quit and not like the game.
Yeah, so we mentioned the Wii U server shutdown is happening, and Mario Maker 1 is essentially going away. And I know we still have Super Mario Maker 2 on Nintendo Switch with an active community and new levels, but what are you going to miss about the original Super Mario Maker and the Wii U in general?
I definitely miss, really, Mario Maker 1 was just, it was a special game, because when Mario Maker 2 came out, we kind of had the first game as a blueprint of, you know, we know how things work, we kind of know what levels are going to come. But when Mario Maker 1 first came out, it was the Wild West. It was like just anything goes, and every day you'd see like 10 new tricks on social media, like somebody shows, what, look how cool this is. And it's kind of different. Like, if they were to make a Mario Maker 3, they'd have a lot of new stuff, but it'll never be the same as just nobody's played with one of these level builders, unless something like Super Meat Boy or something. It was a really new concept, and I'll never forget those first few months with the game. I do like the Wii U gamepad. Just kind of, it feels like the Wii U was the perfect console for Mario Maker. So if they do give us a new game, I hope somehow they get that kind of interaction back, where the Switch just, it's not as good in handheld, I guess, compared to the Wii U. The gamepad's kind of its own thing, instead of the console is the handheld. So I would like to see that, but overall, Mario Maker 2 is, I think it's an upgrade. I think most people do like it, just it's a more complete game, but mostly it's the memories, the community. It was a good time.
But Mario Maker 2 and Team 0% aren't going away, because you are going to clear every single level in Super Mario Maker 2. And that is an ongoing thing, because you can still make levels in that game, unlike in the Wii U version. So how is that project kind of going?
Yeah, so in Mario Maker 2, it is ongoing. We did do a big push a while back to clear the 2019 levels, which that's the year Mario Maker 2 released, and we did clear all of them. And I think we've tallied, there were 200,000 for 2020, and now I think it's down to 96,000 or so. So it is happening slowly, but like you said, yeah, people can still, you can go upload a level right now, and we would have to deal with it at some point. So it's going to be an effort. Mario Maker 1 lasted about 6 years before they stopped allowing level uploads, and Mario Maker 2 is a little over 5 now, I think. But it seems like there's just way more levels out there in general. But yeah, Team 0%, it's one of the most active communities in Mario Maker. Just, it's not any specific skill or subset. If you can find levels that you can probably beat it first try, just it was overlooked, and you don't have to be a crazy skilled player to participate. Anybody can do it and take out just one of the millions of levels that we have to deal with.
Yeah, so we're just about out of time. Where can people find Team 0%? Where can people find you? Go ahead and shout all that stuff out one more time before we wrap up.
Yeah, so Team 0%, the main place they're on is Discord, but it's easy to find the Discord probably through Twitter. It's called Team 0%. It's a very, even if you just aren't super interested in 0%, it's just an active Mario Maker community if you're interested in the game in general. It might be the most active currently. I'll be, whenever Maker 1 shuts down, I'll continue playing Mario Maker 2 0%, and we'll see what happens with that.
All right, well, Tyler, thanks so much for your time. Really appreciate talking about Mario Maker with you, and good luck trimming the herbs over the weekend. Go check him out on Twitch. We'll link to that in the description of this episode so you can go and follow along with that mission. But for now, I will send it back to the main show. And we're back, Logan Plant, alongside Pear Schneider. How you doing, Pear?
Good. That was something, Logan.
Yeah, I know. Mario Maker is awesome. Let's talk about Mario Maker for a second, because it's, Pear, you and I were messaging about this a little bit earlier this week. I just can't believe that Mario Maker is a real thing that Nintendo ever actually did. Handing the tools to Mario level creation over to the fans and just setting them loose with really no restrictions. It's just pretty crazy.
I mean, there's so many Nintendo made projects and experiments that you start to forget, right? Because you always move on to the next thing. And like, then you go back and you think about how unlikely some of these things are, right? Like mini games based on classic NES games remixed, right? Like that, those sort of concepts are really, really cool and fresh. Or Wii Fit, or, you know, any of these weird, like Nintendogs, for Christ's sakes, right? Mario Maker really is really, really special because there's this potential to just break everything that Nintendo so carefully designed over the years and kept you like safe from, like by giving you the tools. I just thought it was just such an awesome project. And Tears of the Kingdom is similar, right? Like where like you are giving tools that you're giving power to destroy the world. Right. And they're just cool with it. And they somehow figure out how to test this to the point where the exploits and the broken bits are kept to a minimum. It was an awesome project. It died a little bit too early for me, and I never got quite back into it with a Switch because the discovery was problematic. Mm-hmm. You know, the actual like
super tough
online
levels.
The sort of community of what happened afterwards wasn't there. And like other games like Roblox have demonstrated how to do it right, right? Like Roblox evolved and it's going to evolve even more, and the world is going to go crazier around what's happening with that game and tool set. But Mario Maker was just kind of like, here's the game, here's how you discover games, here's how you interact with people, and it stopped there rather than developing into a community. And I feel like it kind of railroaded itself into auto runner community stuff, and everything I discovered through the platform was either it played a melody based, you know, it was a music box basically, or it was an auto runner. It was like, don't touch Mario and he'll run through the level and be really funny. And so a lot of good designs weren't discovered because they weren't able to pivot and adjust to the community. And that's Nintendo's relative inexperience with making live service or online games, right?
Yeah, I wonder if Mario Maker is ever going to come back, because I don't know. The Mario Maker 2, it sold very well. It still has an active community, but I fell off of it much faster too, just because the level creation wasn't as good without the Wii U gamepad. I bought a stylus and everything that was compatible with Switch, and it just didn't grip me as much as the original one did on Wii U. I'd like to see it come back in some form. A Mario Maker 3, maybe with the big hook being there is better discovery, better communities and things that you can do. And certainly people have found a way, like the Team 0% community, or like the Super Mario Brothers 5, I think it's called, that was a big Mario Maker project that this one guy, I think his name's Metroid Mike on Twitter, if you want to go find him. But he basically made his own Super Mario Brothers game using the World Creator tool in Mario Maker, and that was really cool. So there's a lot of cool projects in Mario Maker, but it really represented the start of Nintendo just letting go of control a little bit more. We talk about Breath of the Wild, Tears of the Kingdom, Mario Maker's right there too, and these really curated experiences Nintendo is known for, starting to loosen the grip a little bit and let fans kind of go crazy with their own creativity and ideas, and I really like that. And yeah, speaking of Mario Maker, oh, go ahead, Bear.
No, like Sony played around obviously with Dreams and with Little Big Planet, played around with the sort of creative engines, and they really opened up to let you go wild, right? And like the more flexible these tools become, the more they venture into 3D space, the more daunting they become for people who aren't that well versed, aren't as good as creating, you know, modeling 3D objects. I played on the Super Nintendo way back in the days. I played a game called Desaimon, and the series, you know, came back a couple times, and it was a 2D shooter tool. So top down view, you could have parallax scrolling, but everything was sprite based. You had a certain number of ships you can design, and that sort of confined setup, you could do side scrolling or vertical scrolling, that sort of confined setup made it easy to jump in and mess around with it, even though it had like music development tools and cool stuff like that. And I feel like Mario Maker is that, right? Like, because it's focused on the 2D games, I feel like anyone can mess around with it. Obviously, the good people with a real design spark will shine and do something very special compared to us heathens. But I think you're right. I think they're done with Mario Maker, but I would love to see this Link to the Past style Zelda Maker concept. We talked about it in the past. Like, Nintendo still has these 2D franchises that would be ready for a creative game like that. I own the F-Zero expansion kit, which is a track maker. Not accessible. Really hard to do this stuff. I mean, the AI flies off the track if you go too wild
with
your designs.
It's just not game only, right?
So yeah, it's a 6040D one. Yeah, and it's difficult to do this sort of stuff in 3D environments. Like, the audience, the applicable audience just shrinks more and more and more. But, oh man, like, Zelda, Metroid, these are still two franchises. Like, a Super Metroid Maker would be so freaking cool.
Yes, that would be awesome. Well, Nintendo commented actually on your Mario Maker levels this week at GDC during the Super Mario Brothers Wonder panel. This was super funny. A Nintendo designer, Takashi Tezuka, said, "When we played the posted courses, and let's keep this here, some of them were not very good." And I thought that was great that they actually said that. And this whole panel was just really about kind of designing a game in 2D again and coming back to Mario's roots, but doing something brand new with Super Mario Wonder. But that was just a fun little nugget about Mario Maker.
If anyone could design levels like Nintendo, we'd know it, right? Yeah, like, yes. Once in a while, you get a game like Hollow Knight, or we just got a really nice Prince of Persia, where you go, oh man, like, these guys can make a Metroidvania, you know, that rivals Nintendo stuff. Metroid Dread, that's not the core EAD Nintendo team that made that. That rivals, you know, the sort of the level design in Super Metroid and the progression and the certainly the challenge. But yeah, if anybody could do it, Nintendo's designers wouldn't be so revered, and we wouldn't be waiting for every Mario game, even 2D, whether it's 2D or 3D, with high expectations.
Yeah, and something else that really just told me nobody else can do this was the Tears of the Kingdom panel. We have kind of a recap of it up on IGN.com right now, and Pear, this game is just unbelievable. We all already knew it was, but just hearing them talk about it, and I love that Nintendo does these GDC panels, because as we've been talking about, they are very private, and they do hide a lot, and actually just peeking behind the curtain, even for just an hour, about tiny elements of design in Tears of the Kingdom is just so incredibly fascinating. And really the main takeaway being, don't create a fun game, but create a system where fun things happen. And that being the design behind these two Zelda open worlds that have just blown them all away is so incredibly cool. And getting quotes from physics programmers, like, I would hear things like, it broke, it went flying. And I'd respond with, I know, we'll deal with it later. And just the pandemonium they said they were unleashing unleashing in Hyrule during development when Ultra Hand and none of this stuff was working yet. The Zelda developers themselves finding unintended shrine solutions like we all did when the game actually came out last year. Tears of the Kingdom is just incredible. And Pear, I really loved this panel from Nintendo.
I love they talked a little bit about some of the bugs, right? Like where you would create a car and then it would just fly up into the sky.
Yeah.
Right. And that some of the bugs were actually caused by artificial limitations. Like whenever they put on the guardrails too much, there was the potential to break things. And there are still, you know, they're like, this is a kind of like liberal world, physics world, right? Like that big stone slab that's flying around with those two fans, obviously that's not based on real life physics. And they kind of like tweak it for that fun factor to make something work. But then also they allow it to spectacularly fail. And that was one of my favorite things in Tears of the Kingdom. Like if I build a paddle boat, like a river, like a ship with like rotating wheels and paddles on them. And like, I'm slightly off with one of the paddles and I'm like, it's fine, it'll work. And then it just spectacularly fails where the thing gets out of the water and flips and I fall. And you know, it's that, those are the moments that stay with you. And I will also say that in addition to making sure that the world is fun to play and that you feel this sort of freedom, that I think we all stuck 20 tree trunks together and were amazed that the game let you do it and didn't break, right? And it actually ran at a decent frame rate too, crazy enough. Like seeing that sort of stuff is great, but there also needs to be room for frustration. And I think Breath of the Wild did that. And I think it turned off some players initially where, when it's rain, like you want to climb something and it's raining, and the game system is when it's raining and it's wet, you cannot climb easily. You keep on slipping, right? And like to a lot of players, that really turned them away until they learned the sort of ways around that. And Tears of the Kingdom, I think, kind of got around it in many ways. But like, if there's no, you need this sort of frustration and adversity to make you get more creative. I build things because of the limitations, right? Like you might choose a different weapon because there's lightning in the sky and you don't want to get hit, right? And so you are enticed to try something that you wouldn't have tried if the game didn't have that sort of frustration element and limitation. So, man, look, Tears of the Kingdom, I wish I could delete all my memories of these worlds and play them again.
Me too. Yeah, I've actually been mourning a little bit over the last couple of weeks that Tears of the Kingdom's never going to be new again, because it was just so awesome to play through last year. And yeah, I think that I love both Mario Wonder and Tears of the Kingdom a lot. Tears of the Kingdom significantly more. But yeah, so go check out our recaps of these panels because they're awesome. And Tears of the Kingdom is so, so cool. They talk about how they created a physics engine for sound. And this main sound designer was there saying, this game was making noises I'd never heard before. I didn't put those in there. It just made them. It's unbelievable. I don't know how any of it works. It's like magic to me.
I didn't think about this. So like a lot of games simulate an audio source. You can see this when you go back when you go back to older racing games, for example, right? Like they'll create an engine noise. And if you change the camera, the engine noise always stays the same, even though if the camera is you, you're farther removed from the engine. If you're sitting in the car, it should sound differently, right? Games later express that sometimes poorly, where if you had surround sound, if you were in the cockpit, suddenly like it would sound really janky where the car audio was coming from. But they figured this out over time and sound got more sophisticated. But like this game actually generates the audio from the wheel touching the ground. So it's not some pre-created loop of, you know, like when you have a car, you're driving it, you don't just get one engine noise. It's like everything generates the sound. And so it's not just this sort of typical, like the sound changing with the surfaces. It's if it's obscured by something, the sound sounds different. If it's in a cave and you're outside, the sound is different. It's just when you approach the game with that in mind, you realize what a Herculean task it was to actually make this thing, you know? And that's why, you know, there were a lot of developers who were sharing moments from The Legend of Zelda, not based on how it made them feel being in the simulated world, but how it made them feel as programmers looking at a string of panels being connected and buckling under the weight of someone driving over it. And they're like, how, what?
Let's hit the question block. We put up a post in the Nintendo Voice Chat podcast forums on Facebook every week, a couple days before the show, where you can drop your questions if you want them to be answered. This first one comes from Baron, who says, what do you think the big Mario Kart 9 twist should be? Bear, what's your take on this?
Well, I've said this before. I think at this point they need to do Mario Kart 9. Well, I did think that. I thought they should do Mario Kart 9 Ultimate, which is a Mario Kart Ultimate, which is like Smash Brothers. It's a celebration of the entire franchise. But yeah. Deluxe kind of became that already. It has so much stuff in it. This is really difficult. They did no gravity. They've done underwater. They've done two people sitting in the same cart with switchable powers. I would hate to be one of the designers to come up with what would keep this fresh. I think we also agree that Mario Kart is the reason why there's no more F-Zero, because it already does this sort of hover racing stuff. Yeah. My take at this point would be to go to full Nintendo Kart. We've gotten a taste of what it's like to Smash Brothers fi Mario Kart by having Captain Falcon and Link in it and Animal Crossing Villager and so forth. It would be so cool if the next game, it could even be a live service game where like every season is a new Mario game, where like I want to drive through the worlds from the Metroid games. I would love to have this sort of richness of the characters come to it. And then what if they do what they did with Smash Brothers, where you suddenly have your Castlevania and your Final Fantasies in there, and you've got Cloud on his motorbike? Like, that could just be the sort of level of freshness after, I mean, what biome have they not done in a track? They've done everything.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah.
You hinted a little bit at the direction I think this should go, and I think that Mario Kart 9 should be a huge live service push from Nintendo. And I know those are scary words right now, I think, for a lot of people because of how often live service games get shut down. But Nintendo with Splatoon has shown it's getting a better handle onto how to kind of approach a live service thing. And I think you're just not going to be able to match the 96 courses that Mario Kart 8 Deluxe has. You can't launch with that many. And I see it as a struggle to launch with 48 brand new ones. I'm sure they could, and they still might, but a service.
That's a lot.
Even the booster course pass was kind of already live service. Every 3 months, you got 8 new courses, and everybody popped in to play these 8 courses, and they upped how frequently you saw them in the random online lobbies so you could vote for them and play them. Like, they've already done this a little bit, and I think the next full step is launch it with, I don't know, 24 tracks, still a decent amount, and then every 3 months, add 8 more, and do that throughout the entirety of the next console's life cycle, and you'll have a huge winner. Mario Kart 8 Deluxe still has a very active online lobby system. I think that people will show up and play it. And I think on top of that, just to make it feel a little more different, I want 16 racers. I want to jump from 12 to 16 on the track at a time. I think that it's time. They jumped from 8 to 12 before, and I want to see them make another increase.
Yeah, look, there's a lot of disdain around live service games because of the circumstances of a couple of games, right? Where Suicide Squad, some of the negativity was not just based on the game, which, you know, didn't quite deliver the goods. Some people had fun with it, more power to them, but like the reaction was a bit due to the fact that here's the developer who made some of our favorite superhero games of all time. They're being unleashed on a different, slightly different license. You know, obviously Batman was in it, but it was centered around the Suicide Squad. But it wasn't the sort of immersive Metroid Prime-like Arkham Asylum. It was more like a Destiny, like, you know, a game where in order to get everything out of it, you had to play with friends. Not that we don't like friends, but when you get older, it's a lot harder to get people together to play a game when you want to play the game, right? And so not having this sort of comfort of, I can play this single-player experience anytime I want, and it's as good as the older games, that created a lot of, like, just some negativity around it. But let's not kid ourselves. Some of the biggest games in the world are live service games, and they're not the biggest games in the world because they're crap or because people don't want them. You know, Fortnite is a huge game. Lots of people love that combination of like shooting and base building and all of that. And the reason why it's persisted is because because Epic, the developer, keeps updating it with this sort of metaverse expansion content where you get
It's Smash Brothers, right? Like, they basically took Smash and applied it to a third-person shooter. And so when you tune in, suddenly you got Spider-Man in the game, or you've got, you know, or there's a meteor in the sky and something cool happens. We've got Helldivers out now, Helldivers 2. Bummer we don't get that on Switch, but it's that's a game where some people, it's like organic life service updates where some people spot flying bugs in a world and yes. talk about it. And then the developer says, there's no such thing. This is propaganda, right? Like, they play along with this game world, this like Starship Troopers X sort of, you know, little fascist society there. And like, it just becomes a really fun and addictive online experience where it's about seeing what comes next and being surprised by things. And Nintendo's dabbled with it, right? Like with events in their 99 titles, for example, like yes. different mm-hmm. themes. But mm-hmm. I agree with you, Mario Kart could be the one. And like, if you open that up to the entire universe of Nintendo, when it's Metroid's anniversary that month, you get Metroid. When it's Animal Crossing's month, you get Animal
Crossing. Oh, I sure hope Nintendo ever recognizes a Metroid anniversary again. That would be the day.
Yeah, that's right.
But I think that Helldivers is a great shout, because that is a live service game that showed people are still willing to pay $40 for a live service game that they know is going to have this long tail with updates. Because Mario Kart will never be free to play. This is not going to be a free to play game. I know Tour was, but this one's not going to be. No chance. But I do think that they could create a platform with new tracks, new characters, get some third parties in there, get Sonic the Hedgehog in a cart and throw him into Mario Kart. I think that stuff like that would go over really well. So I hope that's the direction. And I think we're going to see it probably around launch of the next hardware, whenever that is.
Just think of the music, like the little tastes we got of, like, you know, Mute City in Mario Kart. Like, I'm greedy. I want more. I really like that mishmash of stuff in Smash Brothers. Smash Brothers Ultimate has the single greatest soundtrack of all time in any video game. There's just no contest. Like, it's cheating. It has music by the best developers in the game, in gaming history, and mashes it all up. And like, Mario Kart could follow that track. You know, part of me goes, well, Smash already did it. Do we really want Mario Kart to do the same? But it's like, there've been so many tracks. Look how many characters there are to choose from. It feels right to expand.
Yeah, and it'll still be called Mario Kart, and I like to think it will still primarily be Mario characters, but like a row of guest characters or a row of guest cups. I don't know if I see them going full on Nintendo Kart. There's just as many Fire Emblem characters as there are Mario characters, because Mario Kart's one of the only places you get to play as some of these C or D tier Mario characters, like a Petey Piranha or a King Boo, who don't appear in other things. I love them, but Mario Kart's kind of all they have. So I think that if you just turned it into the Smash roster, basically, or some version of it, there'd be some things that would be lost. But yeah, I think so.
Nintendo had actually started with the original branding of Smash Brothers. They had actually started this concept. Those games are called Nintendo All-Star Daidanto Smash Brothers, right? So they had Nintendo All-Star was dropped from the US and international release titles, but like, they were signaling that it's not just the brothers, the Mario Brothers thing with Smash Brothers, but Nintendo All-Star, meaning it's this giant crossover world. And like, Nintendo All-Star Mario Kart, hey, that could be a thing, right?
Yes, that would be awesome. I'd be really excited about that. Get me Captain Falcon, get me Samurai Goro, and all those other F-Zero guys we care about so much. But that is all the time we have this week on Nintendo Voice Chat, another episode of NVC in the books. But before we go, we got a couple of favors to ask. If you're watching on YouTube, leave us a like and a nice comment. And if you're listening to us on a podcast app, please leave us a review. It helps us spread the good NVC word and will forever be in your debt. And remember, NVC is the only place where you can
get the thing.